London, Kensington, present day. You're joking. Sylvia Noble's instantly recognisable tone of outrage, one that could undoubtedly repel an entire planetary invasion force of Daleks, sounded in the quiet street as she thumped the car door with her palm in futility. Despite having hit his early 90s, Wilfred Mott had been kept spry in his old age. He was already stepping out the front door of the house to minimise any collateral damage that was about to ensue. Sylvia, he asked, arms outstretched as he hobbled over in his dressing gown and slippers. What's the problem, sweetheart? Sylvia pursed her lips and pointed through the window of the car. She tapped the glass with a pointy nail and made a show of trying to open the door. Keys, she hissed. The end of the world had come.
This is the Shadow Optic, archiving a log file referring to Incident All Soul 3, and I refer to as Death, involving the renegade known as the Doctor. It was intercepted from a brief temporal data glitch upon our last visit to the holes. It was intercepted from a brief temporal data glitch upon their last visit to our holes as we attempted to commandeer their space-time capsule. This audio file seems to contain information regarding the five Saturn class of Indy-Nursery fleet's exodus to Earth 21st century following the loss of the Adipose Free Breeding Planet. Matron Cophelia intended to seed Earth with Adipose life forms by converting the resident human population. She failed and, like so many enemies of the Doctor, perished. According to Article 12, Subsection 145-72 of Shadow Proclamation, this is to be treated as a highly classified document with dangerous implications. Full investigation is pending.
Recording begins.
Is this... just a sec. Ah! Slight temporal interference coming from the grass to take away. Here we go. Amidst the chaotic aftermath of Matron Cophelia's failed invasion, nobody paid attention to the tall, handsome man. That was me, by the way, holding a completely inconspicuous pen, standing by a strange, simple little waste bin. Cophelia really had done some impressive work on this device. They logged seal breakers, induced biological functions, rope cutting, and even, oh yes, even, a built-in perception filter that was able to passively operate across a range of 1 square meter. Well, that would have made her job of infiltrating the human race to set up Adipose Industries much easier, wouldn't it? Of course, I discreetly threw Cophelia's sonic pen into the bin and probably forgot about it. Silly Doctor. I'm making this recording to remind me, at some point in my timeline, to dispose of it properly. Best case scenario, if it's found by somebody else, if the Ace gets a new gadget, or Jack gets a new toy to play with. Worst case, well, if last time was anything to go by, the end of the world, again. Trouble is, it's been a while since I was there. I can't quite remember what bin it was. And it's probably covered by a perception filter now. I'm putting this message into the TARDIS temporal data banks and hoping that the old girl will let one of my past selves know. There. Crisis averted. Hopefully. Feeling hungry now. Turns out the grass takeaway was a holographic decoy to disguise a bowl of pears. Won't be ordering from there again. Fancy some chip shards.
Recording end. London, Chiswick, January 2020.
Donna Temple Noble and her loving husband Sean walked arm in arm, heading back from the local volunteer shelter they ran for the homeless, filling the empty London street with bickering over anniversary presents 1 minute and cackles of laughter the next. She was in her 50s now, but that fire inside her burned as brightly now as it ever had, forever keeping Sean on his toes. To be lost in another person invites a great many dangers in this universe. And the happy couple, these partners in crime, would not learn this lesson for the first time on this day. As Sean recounted a particularly fond memory of how he and Wilf accidentally ended up stranded on a beach in Dvorbrück during the family's cruise the previous year, something which may have resulted from the two of them enjoying a little too much of the free champagne, the danger they faced with the hard object they failed to see, and found themselves accidentally walking into. They both toppled to the ground with a loud crash. Some of the contents of the bin spilled out onto the pavement. Empty packets of crisps, the old water bottle, an old Woolworths branded pick and mix bag proved to be the strangest ancient artifact uncovered by these hapless wanderers, and would, in fact, on other planets be considered a monumental archaeological discovery.
Not that the all of them were to know this. For the first thought that came into their heads was, when on earth was this glass emptied? Right, Donna said, slightly red-faced as she pulled out a pair of plastic gloves from her coat pocket and got to work cleaning up the mess.
Hey, Donna, look at this,
Sean called, holding up something from the debris.
Sean, that's disgusting, she scolded. Put it back in the bin. It still works,
he kicked the pen and wrote on the back of his hand. You are always saying you need more pens. You are always saying you need more pens.
Look, it makes a funny noise too.
Donna rolled her eyes, unable to suppress a smile as Sean strode over to her, holding up the silver and black pen, dramatically bowing his head as he shifted to one knee.
Happy anniversary, Donna.
It's a big one, she said, her hand still on Sean's. Donna felt every moment of the woman she'd become over the last decade as she took hold of the pen. Laughing hard with her family, her friends, running fast, mainly to work off the Christmas dinners, and, most importantly, being kind. This was the tale of Donna Noble. This was the tale of Donna Temple Noble. And there was nowhere else in the universe she would rather be to live. London, Kensington, present day. The scene outside the house carried its usual amount of dignity as Donna poked her head out the front door. Her mother shouting at an inanimate object. Her grandfather standing there in a dressing gown and slippers, trying to pull her away from the car. What's going on? Donna asked. She's locked the keys in, Wolf chuckled. Donna tilted her head.
Again?
She pulled something from her pocket and pointed it at the car. It had been a long time since Wolf and Sylvia had heard that sound, that unmistakable sound. They simply stared at each other in a stunned, flustered silence, most practically agape as the car door clinked open and Donna retrieved the keys, pocketing her sonic pen as she did so. There you go. She gave them an odd look for their reaction, then rattled the keys in front of Sylvia before casually dropping them into her hand like it was nothing. Well, end of the world averted, Mother. Donna Temple Noble went back inside to catch the start of Bake Off without another word.